As my own kids entered elementary school, I was surprised to discover that constipation is a common reason for children to miss activities. This aligns perfectly with the research that we're looking at today and the growing concern that constipation has become a public health problem. Constipation accounts for almost 1 in 20 visits children make to a doctor, and studies show that 10% of children and adolescents in the U.S. suffer from chronic constipation. So naturally, occupational therapy professionals are starting to see more of these kids on their caseloads, which brings us to today's article examining what an interdisciplinary approach to pediatric constipation can look like. After we review the article, we are excited to welcome to the podcast Quiara Smith, an OT who owns a pediatric pelvic health practice. She and I will discuss the practical implications of this research for your OT practice. So let's dive in. Welcome to the OT Potential Podcast, where we review new and influential OT journal articles, then invite on an expert guest to help us pull out actionable takeaways that you can implement in your practice starting today. Welcome to the podcast. I'm your host, Sarah Lyon, OTRL. And before we dive into this big topic of OT and pediatric constipation, I wanted to let you know that this podcast may qualify as continuing education for you. You are probably listening to this podcast on a free podcast platform, but to gain CEU credit, you will need to be a member of the OT Potential Club, our OT continuing education platform. So bearing in mind that this could count as a CEU course, I wanted to state our two learning objectives so you can be thinking about them throughout the podcast today. Our first learning objective is you will be able to recognize assessments that OTs can utilize with pediatric clients with constipation. And second, you will be able to identify common interventions that OTs can utilize for pediatric clients, again, with constipation. So let's begin by looking at our journal article, and then we will bring on Quiara to discuss how this could play out in your practice. The article that we are reviewing today is called Interdisciplinary Occupational and Physical Therapy Approach to Treating Constipation and Fecal Incontinence in Children. This article comes to us from the Journal of Physical and Occupational Therapy in Pediatrics, and it was published in 2022. As many as 32% of children ages 0 to 18 experience constipation. The primary types of constipation are organic and functional. Children who have a history of organic or functional constipation may experience retentive fecal incontinence. This is defined as a passage of stool into the underwear or in a socially inappropriate place with the presence of functional constipation. This has been found to impact 4.4% of children in the U.S. So what are the standard treatments for constipation? The standard medical treatment for constipation involves the pharmacotherapy of oral laxatives. But this treatment alone is often inadequate. In fact, approximately 40% of patients who were prescribed oral laxatives had frequent relapses or simply did not respond to treatment. Non-pharmacological therapy has the potential to help treat the multifactorial nature of constipation. This can be beneficial as these children often present with additional impairments such as negative or avoidant behaviors, decreased body awareness, poor diet and fluid intake, inhibited or hypertonic pelvic floor muscles. Just as my own note on this section, I found a really great systematic review on the science of non-pharmacological treatment, which I will link to in the show notes. So while the research on non-pharmacological therapy is still early, the evidence supporting therapy for this particular condition is growing. So what is the role of OT and PT in intervention? Past research has found clinically significant outcomes in children treated for constipation by an OT or PT. There are several great journal articles on this, which again, I will link to in the show notes so you can dig in a little deeper here. So even though we have this early stage research, there's still limited evidence exploring a coordinated OT and PT approach to addressing this issue in conjunction with standard medical treatment. In theory, this multidisciplinary approach could help address the multifaceted and complex nature of constipation, which leads us to this paper. So what was the purpose of this research? The purpose of this case report is to demonstrate a coordinated OT and PT approach to successfully evaluating and treating two children with functional constipation and fecal incontinence. Looking at the background and framework for both of these cases, an OT and PT co-evaluation took place in the clinic. Then, individual OT and PT treatment sessions were scheduled, usually back-to-back, to address goal areas. The OT, PT, child, and parents collaborated weekly on goal areas and home programming. The OT and PT involved in this case were both trained in pediatric pelvic floor therapy, in SEMG biofeedback, and pelvic floor rehabilitation ultrasound imaging, along with functional constipation. For the purposes of this article, I'm going to share an overview of case study number one. I definitely encourage you to read the full article for all the details, again, especially on case study number two. So looking at the case description for child number one, the child was a 10-year-old, typically developing male, who has experienced fecal incontinence and constipation for greater than 5 years. The child had a history of trauma and abuse, including exposure to drug use and intermittent parent involvement. The child was wearing pull-ups both day and night. He was voiding urine in the toilet 4 to 6 times per day. However, bowel movements in the toilet had decreased in frequency since moving in with extended family 3 years prior. He has been having 1 to 2 bowel movements in his pull-up daily with varied consistency of type 2 to type 6 on the Bristol stool chart. Leakage of stool occurred daily at varying times and regardless of activity. Associated with the decreased frequency of bowel movements, the children often had emotional outbursts when prompted to use the toilet. A kidney ureter and bladder x-ray revealed mild to moderate stool backup, and subsequently, the child was prescribed a daily stool softener and Miralax. At the time of the evaluation, the child was refusing to take both medications due to taste aversion. I encourage you to see the full article with more on the clinical findings associated with this case. But for now, let's head into the assessment. The child presented with signs of dysfunctional elimination with pelvic floor muscle incoordination and underactivity. He also demonstrated significant fear of having bowel movements in the toilet. The child had moderate constipation. Cognition, attention, and language skills impacted his ability to understand concepts related to functional and independent use of the bathroom. From here, the article shares a table of the goals that were written for this patient. Both case studies have really nice goal banks for you to look at that really show you what the treatment entailed. I'm going to read almost the majority of the goals set for this patient, just again, because I think they're so helpful to hear. So some of the goals set for this child were: patient and family will be educated on complete abdominal massage for constipation management, performed 5 to 7 days over 3 consecutive weeks. Next, patient will improve pelvic floor muscle endurance to 5 seconds work, 5 seconds rest for 5 consecutive repetitions. Next, patient will be able to verbalize 3 feelings related to incontinence challenges and accept help from others as needed without emotional reaction 80% of the time. Next, patient will be able to complete 5 reps of diaphragmatic breathing before and after voiding to encourage relaxation of pelvic floor muscles and emptying. And this will be for 80% of our opportunities for 3 consecutive sessions. Next, patient will be educated on and demonstrate wiping self independently after bowel movement for 3 consecutive sessions. Next, patient will increase pelvic floor muscle isolation from a level of using accessory muscles 100% of trials to a level of little to no observed use of accessory muscle activation while completing contraction relaxation exercises. Patient will be able to attend community and school events with no more than 1 bowel leak across all activities in 1 week. And patient will demonstrate understanding of urinary and digestive systems as evidenced by completing a simple drawing of systems with 80% accuracy within 4 sessions. So those were the goals. And looking at interventions, the child was seen by either a PT or OT for 18 weekly sessions. Details on those sessions are provided in the article, but here's a high-level overview of the types of intervention. There was client and family education, abdominal massage, PNF contract and relax, SEMG biofeedback, breathing and relaxation, sensory and urge awareness, wiping and hygiene, voiding, primitive reflex integration, emotional and self-regulation, routine, diet hydration, and a home program. So what were the outcomes? The child met 13 out of 15 therapy goals. The remaining two will continue to be addressed by home programming. Looking at additional outcomes reported by the caregiver included improvement in the child's self-esteem during peer interactions, as well as improved family dynamics. The child said that he was now wearing underwear without fear of having a leak, and that he felt more confident at school. He also became more willing to accept help from a caregiver. So headed into the author's discussion and conclusion, this case series provides evidence of two children achieving full continence with a coordinated OT and PT approach. This approach is uniquely beneficial as it allows each therapist to focus on their area of specialty while also increasing the likelihood that all factors contributing to incontinence are addressed. In order to determine whether outcomes associated with this approach are more successful than standard treatment, more robust comparative studies are needed. Okay, that is our article review, and this was just such a fascinating read to get this in-depth look at these cases. But per usual, I read this research and walked away with more questions than I had answers. And I'm so thankful to be welcoming to the podcast today an expert in this field, Quiara Smith. Quiara has been a practicing occupational therapist for over 13 years in both California and in Hawaii, working in various settings, including hospitals, schools, and an equine center providing hippotherapy, in addition to outpatient clinics. Her pediatric experience encompasses serving infants, toddlers, children, and adolescents with various medical conditions and diagnoses. Realizing the social, emotional, and psychological challenges that pelvic floor dysfunction places on children and families, Quiara decided to niche down her private practice to exclusively treating children and adolescents with pelvic floor dysfunction and toileting challenges. Quiara utilizes a holistic and integrative approach to pediatric pelvic floor dysfunction. She partners with her canine assistant, Nelly, a Labrador Golden Retriever cross, in guiding children towards continence with confidence. As a financial disclosure, I do want to highlight that Quiara teaches courses on pediatric pelvic health, and you can find those courses on her website, Aloha Integrative Therapy. So without further ado, I will patch Quiara onto this podcast. Welcome to the podcast, Quiara. It's great to have you.
Thank you so much, Sarah, for having me. I'm excited to be here.
I am so excited about this topic. I was actually introduced to it via your private practice. Like, somehow it came on my radar and I was like, what is this specialty private practice? It's so hard to run a pediatric private practice, and then to have such a niche one just like sparked my curiosity and made me realize I didn't have any foundational knowledge about this topic. So I'm so excited to hear your story today and just hear more about the needs in this area. But before we get there, I just want to start with you and your background and just how you found this pediatric pelvic health area of practice.
Well, I had never heard about it, ever. Not even during my time in graduate school to become an OT. And it wasn't until I started to work for a specialty children's hospital in the San Francisco Bay Area called Lucile Packard Children's Hospital at Stanford, where I worked as an outpatient OT, that I learned about it. And they were really interested in my skill set as having mindfulness and yoga. And my supervisor was like, you know, would you like to learn about this area and serve this patient population? And I am game for learning new things and jumping into it and really immersing myself in learning. Because as an OT, lifelong learning is something that we sign up for when we become an OT. And when I learned more about how pediatric pelvic health OT supported these children and families who were struggling with bowel and bladder dysfunction and pediatric pelvic floor dysfunction, I really was surprised at how much we as OTs could support them. And it was definitely an area that ignited my passion and really wanted, I really wanted me to open the doors to how we can support this patient population better.
Does that mean there were clients coming to this practice already with this need? Like they were seeking help already and then the clinic was looking to train more people in it?
Correct. Yes, that's exactly it. And the background for them to open this type of service in the children's hospital was that the pediatric GI doctors and urologists were looking for practitioners to support the children who were coming to them for help. And the pediatric PTs didn't want to do it at this particular organization. So then the OTs jumped in. And so that's where we really were able to provide our OT lens in supporting pelvic health in children. So it was an already established program. And I was so fortunate enough to be able to jump in and learn. And it really was this amazing experience where my passion was really ignited.
Now that you're like a leader in this space for OTs, do you see that early experiences being really unique where there was that patient population already? Or is that happening all over the country and PTs and OTs are already doing this work? Or was where you were at unique and already drawing that clientele?
Where I was at was already unique because it's not a well-known area of practice for rehab, right?
Yep.
For even
that would have been my guess.
Or OC. But it is happening across the United States and internationally where therapists are learning how to serve pediatric pelvic floor dysfunction in outpatient clinics, private practices, in specialty children's hospitals. So it's definitely growing, and it's a huge need that we have to have more specialists in this area.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about the jump from learning this in this outpatient clinic to starting your own practice. Like what? That's a big jump in my mind. What made that happen? Like the need, your own personal circumstance. And then what does that practice look like today?
Wow, that is a great question. And I will say it's a combination of all those things that you mentioned. So my own personal circumstance, I was transitioning into motherhood. So being able to have that role of a mother was a priority for me. And to be able to have the flexibility in time to be with my baby at that special moment in my life. And also the need. I saw the need from working in that particular setting on how to support children and families who were struggling with toileting difficulties. And I also saw some of the limitations with that particular setting of a large hospital environment and the high caseload, but also the difficulties with just patient compliance because of how the systems were kind of set up there. Don't get me wrong, it was still a wonderful opportunity and it really opened my eyes to how we could improve healthcare, but also how do we as practitioners align with our values and how we want to practice and how we want to serve. And so that's kind of the transition for me was the role of being a mother, but also how can I serve in a way that aligns with some of the values I have with supporting parents and families and children. And with the private practice, I was able to
you know, have an hour and a half with my patients and my clients and really give them that unique client-centered approach that I saw was super valuable in how they progressed with care. And there was more buy-in. There was more rapport building. And it didn't seem as rushed as in the hospital setting, right? So when we're under that kind of umbrella of an organization, there are different expectations than when we are in our own private practice. Creating the culture of care is really what I focus on. And how do I approach that? And how do I help create and continue to innovate that for my clients and my patients? And there's a specific type, right, of client and patient that gravitates towards my work. And I always tell families that, you know, there is a therapist out there that is going to have the gifts that you need in order to serve you at this moment in your life. And it doesn't necessarily have to be me. Yes, I have this experience, but that doesn't matter. And people look at me like I'm nuts. They're like, what do you mean? Like, what do you mean that doesn't matter? It's you're like, you know, this expert and people know you and you have really great outcomes. And I say, yes, I hear what you're saying, but it's because the people that work with me and really invest that time and that energy, we're meant to be together. And we have that synchronicity. And there's someone out there, another provider for you that is going to do that for you and your child. But it's sometimes difficult because, you know, that concept of I'm coming to see a provider and you're going to fix my problems is something that I think societally it is a message that we are given. You go to a healthcare provider, they're supposed to fix your problems. If they don't, then they're not good. Or, you know, you need to seek care somewhere else. And I think there's just so many layers to that that we can do a better job, I think, to explain that to some of the people we serve.
Mm-hmm. I just think that's one of our biggest challenges as OT is resetting that expectation and communicating clearly too that like go somewhere and be fixed doesn't work most of the time, like yeah. Especially yeah. with the clients that we see.
Absolutely.
I love that you've been able to find that ideal client match a lot of the time. When you're a private pay practice, I can see this being work that would be reimbursed by insurance. Like it feels like pretty straightforward OT to me. Do you know of other practices that are making that work with insurance? Okay.
So for me, my choices for private practice, every business owner, every OT practitioner has their reasons why, right? They decide on private practice versus taking insurance. And I think having the ability to take insurance is great, but there's also some limitations with that. There have been private practices that I know about that are, you know, big OT outpatient clinics that have a variety of disciplines. So they have PT, OT, speech, and they have that model where they take insurance and they also provide some pediatric pelvic floor interventions. And I see the other side of it too, like myself, someone in private practice who is a smaller clinic, and they are able to provide super bills in order for patients in the area that they serve to receive reimbursement. And those patients, for my experience, my patients, I would say 85 to 90% of their costs are reimbursed. And so I like to ask that too. And I keep track, right? Data. We need to have KPIs in our business, what's working, what's not, and what are the things that we can also pass on to newer prospective clients and patients to say, hey, these are the companies, the insurance companies that some of my clients and patients have been able to get reimbursement for. And this could be really helpful. And I think being transparent and giving them those numbers and that data is really important because it gives them informed consent on, okay, this is what I'm looking at when I'm making a decision to invest in this health and wellness for my child and for my family, essentially. And that's the other shift, I think, when I was talking about previously with the culture of kind of my practice and my approach, it's really partnering and collaborating with families and clients to say, I know that this is a difficulty and there are so many moving pieces to it. Let's look at each piece and let's talk through it versus this is what it is, make a decision. And I think in healthcare, that's what has been previously practiced is this is what it is, take it or leave it. And I would love to move away from that and have a more harmonious type of relationship with our clients and with our families and make sure that everyone's on the same page and we're moving forward together.
I have one more just like big picture question before we get to this article. I was just shocked by the percentages of kids that experience constipation. It said like up to 30%, 1 in 20 doctor's visits are about this. So the need is out there. I have a couple questions related to that. Do those numbers reflect what you see? Are those people actively seeking out help? Like, has it been hard or difficult to fill your caseload? And one more question about that. Sorry to hit you with so many at once, but how does this relate to urinary incontinence? The article didn't mention that, but does it go hand in hand? Which one do you see more? I'll stop there because I have so many questions about that.
Yeah, so 100% these statistics in the article reflect what I see in my community and my client caseload. To be honest, I think it's probably a higher percentage than what was stated in the article since my practice exclusively treats pediatric pelvic health conditions. So you would think inherently the children and the teens that come to see me are having either bowel or bladder conditions that are affecting function. And I do believe that because I am in this exclusive type of practice that's very niche, it's inherent in the work. So off the top of my head, caseload-wise, I probably have 99% of my clients struggling with constipation. And people are going to be like, oh my gosh, that's huge. Do you mean like just 99% of every kid that walks through your door has constipation? I said, yes, or that they have had it in the past and they have it sporadically. So it comes back like waves. And that piece about urinary incontinence is huge because there is such a link and an association between constipation and urinary incontinence that most people don't know about. And how I like to describe it is with physiology, right? So the rectum and the bladder, they are very close neighbors. So the colon, the whole GI system, right? The end of the GI system and the bladder, and they sit in the body and they're neighbors together. So if one misbehaves, it can cause the other to misbehave. So the example is if the colon is full of stool, it is pushing on the bladder because there's only so much capacity inside the pelvis, right? And so it can cause the bladder to squeeze and to leak. And so that's how typically children experience bedwetting. And people say, well, how can that be? It's because of that anatomy. And if we're not emptying the rectum and having stools every day, it can build up and it could continue to push on that bladder to where it spasms. Sometimes the symptoms are urinary daytime incontinence of children and teens. And our first thoughts as pelvic floor specialists working with children is always ruling out constipation. And when we educate other healthcare providers about this, like pediatricians or PAs or nurse practitioners who are not aware of it, it is a learning opportunity for them. But it's also, it empowers them because when they see this, in another patient, they're going to be able to address it. And I think that's the biggest piece of it is passing on that education so children can get the support that they need. And then parents can get the education as well that they need. Because oftentimes they're told your child is doing this on purpose. They have a behavioral or psychiatric problem. They have oppositional defiance, when in reality, there are a lot of reasons why a child is having these types of symptoms. So constipation can be one of the symptoms that a child is having because they are not fully emptying their rectum every day, right? And so that's the diagnostic criteria of assessing constipation, is that they have to meet certain requirements in order to say that they have functional constipation versus organic. And I mean, you go through that in your article review very nicely. And so I think it's really having that understanding that the bowel function of a child can impact their bladder and vice versa. If there's an issue with the bowels, it can also be because of the bladder. So we really have to figure out and be detectives about what is really going on for these kiddos that land in our care.
My mind is just blown by that. I've never heard that description of physiology. I would have guessed that the two were linked, but I did not know that how you described it until right now, which surprises me as a mother and as an OT that I'm just learning this. But that feels like such helpful and key knowledge. I can see bedwetting almost being like one of the first visible signs of constipation for some people too. Like I'm thinking of my own kids where 100%. I may not pick up on that they're constipated until I saw something really obvious like bedwetting.
Yeah. And the crazy part about it is that sometimes children can be stooling, having, you know, poops, smooth sausages, type 4 sausage poops every single day, but still be constipated. And people are like, what do you mean, Quiara? Like, how does that work? And I say, well, they could be letting stuff out, but it doesn't mean it's fully empty. So there's stuff still left there overnight. And then they go to sleep and that pressure is put on the bladder. And then the sphincters relax and release because the child is sleeping. So that's one of the things that we always try and rule out, is if constipation is a culprit for any kind of urinary incontinence, whether day or night.
Well, I so now see the need for OT in this area, and turning to this article where we got these really nice case studies. I'm curious to hear what your takeaways were from the article. I've never reviewed an article of case studies, so just overall, I loved seeing all the detail about what treatment looked like for these two kiddos. But with your expertise knowledge, what stood out to you in the article?
Yeah, honestly, when I first read that article, it was as if someone was in my head scribing what they were watching me do with some of my clients. Similar things, not exactly everything, but a lot of similar things that I do in my practice day in and day out. But in reality, there's only one of me, right? So in the article, there are two providers, and they are from different disciplines. So we have a PT and an OT. And I always say, in the perfect world, I mean, that would be amazing to be able to have different providers with their expertise and their clinical skills looking at specific patient needs and clients' needs, to be able to come collaboratively and interdisciplinary in order to best serve that client or patient. Like, that is an ideal situation. For many of us, this is not our reality, right? But I think that the article does a very beautiful job in outlining the specifics of what we do as pediatric pelvic floor specialists, whether you're an OT, a PT, or a physiotherapist. We have the skill set in order to look at what limitations or difficulties the child is having that's specifically related to toileting incontinence for children. With my OT lens, right, I'm really looking at it with this sensory, with this trauma-informed, with this really occupation-centered lens that the PT wouldn't necessarily have in their training, right? So I think for the majority of therapists that are working in this space, the trainings that we have out there currently have been really wonderful and foundational in how we can support these children and families, even though we're from different disciplines. Something else that stood out to me was their outcomes. I think in, you know, the article, they were talking about how that the clients were meeting particular goals, and they had many goals.
Yes.
For these clients, which I think sometimes could be very overwhelming for parents and educators and other healthcare providers serving the client. But also, I think it shows us the level of robust interventions that these therapists were providing to their clients, which is wonderful because there's two of them. And so that is another piece of it. Of course, they're going to have more goals, but really what are they focusing each session on was clear in having their goals. Another piece of it was I was interested and curious to see the aspect of parent caregiver involvement and how they manage that. I would have loved to hear more about that piece of it because in my work, I really focus on that piece. The parent or caregiver, how do we empower them? How do I empower them in order to move forward with some of the plan of care that we've created together in this collaborative way? I focus on self-regulation. I focus on trauma-informed practices with the caregiver and patient in order to be in that space where they can be present for those difficult moments when their child is saying, no, I don't want to do those exercises. No, I'm not going to the bathroom. I'm going to hold my pee all day, et cetera, right? So I really would have loved to see what their management of that piece would have been. And yeah, I think those are the things that stood out to me the most.
Mm. I love getting that peek into your expert brain of what's standing out to you as you're reading. I think I want to now just kind of go dive into each part of the treatment process and hear from you, like, what's the top priority to you in these different aspects of care. Starting with evaluation, like as you're walking in to see a client for the first time, what's on the top of your mind or what would be helpful for OTs in a similar, seeing a similar client? Like what should we be thinking of during evaluation?
Yeah, so for me, walking into an evaluation, I have a centering moment. And a centering moment for me is, I have the capacity in this role to offer compassion, love, respect, and support to these human spirits that have landed in my care. I am grateful and I have gratitude for this opportunity to share the gifts that I have in a way that aligns with them or not, and be okay with that. So it's really coming from a place of, I'm going to be totally present with these people and these spirits. And I think that's very different from when we're in different types of environments where it's rushed and we're, you know, our productivity needs to be on point and we're doing all these things. But I think my practice really affords me the opportunity to be in this way and hold space for these difficulties. It is not easy. I have a 5-year-old. I know what it feels like to be a parent in a busy world with all the pressures we have. And, you know, the families that come and land in my care, they have additional stressors and additional challenges. And I'm just one piece of the puzzle. And that's kind of how I approach it. So, you know, I do my homework on the people that are coming to be evaluated that day. I look at their background. I have certain questions. But before I go and step into that role, right? As a practitioner and provider, I really have that centering moment. And I think that self-regulation piece, when I do participate in that assessment with them, it is key. They see me and they say, this person I can have a secure attachment with. They are present in their body. They are here for me. I get on the level of the child. I am breathing. I am working on my heart rate variability to make sure that I am providing some stability and some security for that child. And even if the child is not engaging with me right off the bat, I am still being present in my body and being present with that caregiver. And then I kind of outline what am I doing? So the expectations are there and they know what's to come. With trauma-informed approaches, being able to keep the nervous systems of the folks that we're serving on this kind of calm parasympathetic wave is the best kind of focus we can have, I think. And with pelvic floor dysfunction, I know, and those of you who have worked with clients who have toileting difficulties know that there's a lot of anxiety, there's a lot of frustration, a lot of overwhelm on everyone's parts, the client, the patient, and then the parent and caregiver who are bringing them in. So having that nervous system regulation is key. And then I look at the body functions, right? So how are they going to the bathroom? Are they standing, sitting? So we're talking through this while the child is engaging with things in my clinic that are sensory types of activities that can get them into that rhythmic motor type of body movement. So they're staying in this nervous system plane of regulated or safe. And I want to make sure that first meeting is an opportunity for them to understand that I am a safe person. And they don't necessarily have to interact with me, right? So like a lot of my clients don't have the verbal communication to tell me, you know, what are you feeling? But we get there as we build that rapport. So again, I'm looking at, body function. So how are they peeing? How are they pooping? The frequency? What does that look like when it's coming out? What is their sensory needs? What are their sensory needs? Can you tell me routines and things that they engage in? What do they love? So using strengths-based approaches is huge. And really looking at what are the roles, habits, and routines of this child and this family? And how is toileting and continence layered into that? And what are the things that they've tried before that necessarily haven't worked? What strategies, what types of, medications or interventions? So getting like a whole background of what's been happening, even though I have the intake form and information, I still like to hear from them. And so they have the opportunity to tell their story to someone like myself who's ready to hear it and listen to it and hold space for it. And I often say, I know that you love your child or your grandchild or whoever this child is, and you would do anything for them. And I'm here for you, and I know it's hard. And just saying that sometimes, oh, you just see this drop, right? This just like, oh, this heaviness just lifts off. I know it's difficult and I'm here and it's going to get better and we're going to work on it together. We're going to be detectives and I'm here. I'm up for the challenge, right? And making them understand that they can be safe with me. So it's not only the child's nervous system that has to be safe and secure with me. It's the parent and caregiver too. They have to have the confidence and the trust in me in order to help move them through that. That's empowerment, right? I am empowering them to dig deep and say, okay, this is my guide, but I really have to do some of the hard work. And I tell them, this child goes home with you for so many hours a day, every single day, and you are the expert, but also I might be an expert in this little piece of this little small piece of your child. Your child has millions of beautiful gifts and talents. And this is just something that we're just going to need a little bit more help with. And I'm here to support you in any way I can. And so that's kind of how I started off. And then we go into maybe looking at primitive reflex integration assessments. And then we look at, pelvic floor muscle coordination, if that's available and the child feels safe to do that. We look at core strength. We look at coordination, overall coordination, and just really figuring out what do they want to work on? What are the priorities? What are their goals? And they tell me three goals. And I don't sway them either way. I'm not like, well, you know, he's in a pull-up. You should be, you know, going in the toilet. No, I don't lead them. I say, what are the goals that you have? And that's being culturally responsive. How am I going to support you? Because I'm not going to tell you what you should do with your child. I'm not the parent or caregiver. So I think that is kind of my approach to the evaluation piece. And then we come up with a plan of care.
Hmm. And I love hearing that you set those goals, or those goals come from the patient. And are they usually what we would call like occupation based? Like, I want to be able to do this. Like, is there a theme of goals that people tend to set for themselves?
Yeah. So I am an occupational therapist to my core and in my spirit. So my goals for my patient and my clients are always occupation centered. So when they say something to me, like an example could be, I want my child to not have any pee leaks or pee accidents. And I say, okay, that's a great goal, but I'm going to push you a little bit further, right? So what would it look like if your child didn't have that and they were participating in something that they love? And they take a second and they say, well, they go to preschool and they really love playing on this one spinning type of playground equipment. And I say, great. So how about we say, you know, your child name will be able to spin on the playground equipment every day without having leaks of pee or, you know, during that time, and to have a, what is the feeling? What is the, that psychosocial piece to it? So they can feel confident about playing with their friends, right? So it's different. It's very different. And people are like, what do you mean? And I say, because I'm an occupational therapist, like everything is occupation centered in my world. And that is what the child needs to be able to do in order to feel fulfilled. You know, what are the things you do? And you know, some of the goals in the article are very specific. So I have goals like that, but it's different in they'll be able to do these exercises, but what is the key piece? What is the meaningful piece? The meaning is not doing exercises. It's so they can, what? Go to bed without feeling anxiety and waking up feeling refreshed. Being able to not have a leak during gymnastics so they can feel, you know, proud of taking care of their body and interact with others in the environment, on their team. So these are things that are a little bit nuanced and different about goals that I have for my clients.
Yeah, I love that. And I can imagine then, since they're being derived from what the parent and child are saying, that they're so oriented to those goals, they're motivated for them. Like, it feels like such a guiding light for your sessions.
And it's specific. It's specific to that child. Super specific, right? And so sometimes, you know, the goals that we have in our brain as therapists, you know, of course, yeah, we want them to do X, Y, and Z with this repetition and meet these, you know, ranges or whatever. Like, those are all well and good, but it could be better. It could be really client-centered. It could be really patient-centered if we just take that occupation-centered lens and utilize it, because then it gives it meaning. It's not just, okay, did you do your exercises this week, Sarah? Okay, well, I did, but like, what? How was it? How was it when you went to gymnastics? Were you able to, remember when we were doing those exercises and you squeezed? And when you come down and landed, like, did you do that? And what was the feeling? How, you know, tell me about it. I'm curious to know. So it's different, right? It's different in that way, in that approach.
thinking about intervention, it sounded like you do a lot of the treatments that were reflected in the article. I think the question I want to ask about treatment is, are there, of the possibilities, what seems to have the biggest impact for clients? And if someone's like a newbie in this area, is there like a treatment that's like a low-hanging fruit that we could all do that tends to help a lot of people?
Yeah, I think the low-hanging fruit, especially for OTs, is that sensory integration. That sensory integration activities specifically for interoception is huge. I mean, most of the clients that I have, that is always a goal, is to improve that, enhance it in order to be able to be connected to the body. And most of the time, when we are, you know, really looking at that low-hanging fruit and putting a lot of energy and effort into that, that's a foundational piece for continence. So it definitely is something that I would recommend, and it's a go-to for sure for me, for every single one of my clients.
And is that just like awareness of like urge? Tell me a little bit more about that. Like, what does that mean?
So for interoception specifically, it's urge sensation, but it's also feeling. So it's also emotions. So the feeling or the emotion of anxiety, overwhelm, fear, right? All those kinds of feelings, that has a direct impact on the pelvic floor. And if we're able to understand feeling, and then we can also understand our organ feelings, right? So those things, the idea is that you can improve the ability to be aware, self-aware of those things, and then do something to, one, improve that state, and two, make it to where it's just habit or like routine. And sometimes it's switched where a child feels discomfort about feeling stool in their rectum. And so their action is to hold and not let go. But that's not very functional over time. Yes, of course, we have to do that when we're driving in a car and we don't have access to a restroom and we need to hold. But that's been their habit and pattern because of the discomfort they feel initially from having that sensation of having to go to the bathroom. So we have to help them figure out how to partner with their body when that sensation happens, an action that could be more helpful to their body versus this, it's like a survival. It's a survival type of reaction to an internal feeling. And that's a lot of the trauma work too, is working on that piece as well. The other sensory systems, I've noticed in the patients that I serve that they have sensory differences that are impacting their ability to feel safe or secure to go to the restroom. So an example is going into a public restroom and having the automatic flush or the hand dryers or the smell, like all these things can be impacting children and teens to not want to use a bathroom and take care of their bodies. So those sensory needs and differences need to be assessed and addressed in order to help move them through those difficulties.
It feels like there's so much to learn in this area. I'm curious, for someone who is interested in addressing constipation in their practice, what advice do you have for them for where to go? Like, where does that process start? Yeah. What advice do you have for next steps? Say, listen to this podcast. What should they do next? Do we have a lot of the skills already? Is there a lot more training? Who do we need to collaborate with? Where do we go?
Yeah, I think we already have the skills, the foundational skills required to address this. Even if you haven't done the trainings yet, specifically in pelvic health or pelvic floor for children, like I mentioned, the sensory component, the reflexes, looking at roles, routines, and habits, like what are the things around toileting and pelvic floor health and bowel and bladder function that you can ask and be curious about in order to see, is this an area that really needs to be addressed for this learner or student in the school system I'm working at or this client in an outpatient practice I'm working at, and then be able to either, one, get more education and training by taking continuing education courses on the specific topic of pelvic health in children and constipation. And then two, if that's not the road that you want to go down, is being able to refer to someone like myself or a pediatric pelvic floor physical therapist in the area. And I think just knowing about it and addressing it, it is so imperative and important because you're not just dismissing it, which usually it is being dismissed, especially if the child is older. So say they're, you know, 5, 6, and I'm not saying, you know, because I see infants and toddlers as well. So I say older, like 5 or 6, because sometimes these issues have started in infancy or toddlerhood. So when they're school age, it's probably been a few years that they've been having to manage this and they've been dismissed. Oh, they're going to outgrow it. Oh, don't worry. They're just going to figure it out. But when it's affecting function and self-esteem and self-confidence and the relationship between child and caregiver, that's a problem. That's a red flag in my book. And it doesn't matter how old the child is. If it's impacting function and life, it is a problem that needs to be addressed. So I would urge and encourage therapists to, yeah, be more curious, get the education. There's the International Continence Society for Pediatrics that has wonderful resources. There's also many different types of Facebook groups about constipation, also specifically pediatric pelvic health occupational therapists. There's a Facebook group that I started that is a wonderful resource, and others out there. So the information is out there. It's just figuring out where you're going to for the sources and then also for the trainings. That's an important piece of it, and mentorship.
Has there been professional relationship building in your area that's been particularly fruitful for your practice? Like, I would imagine you would want to know your local urologist, and even if you can, general practice doctors in your area, I would think that they would love to refer out for this problem. Has that been the case for you?
Yeah, absolutely. I love collaborating with various practitioners in my local community, but I also love to collaborate with so many amazing practitioners in the virtual space. And I feel like some of the practitioners that are part of, I call it like my team, are other pediatric pelvic health therapists, because we learn from each other and we really share resources because we are a smaller group. It's something that networking is essential, especially when we're continuing to grow and help each other, because it is an emerging practice field for OT. And I also collaborate very closely, like you mentioned, with pediatricians in my local area, because of the difficulties they are seeing when pharmacological interventions aren't working, right? Because that's the first line for constipation. So when it is not an acute issue anymore, that's when pediatricians have really found my help, my work to be super helpful. Pediatric urologists and PD gastroenterologists are also part of my team, and naturopathic doctors, which they really focus on that different piece of integrative medicine. When, say, a client or a patient hasn't had success with conventional Western medicine, that's also professionals that I collaborate with. And then we also look to psychologists. We look to dietitians and nutritionists, and then also body workers. So those could be craniosacral therapists and also myofascial release practitioners. So you can see it's really a collaborative approach to helping a child and a family move through some of these difficulties.
This sounds just like such a complex practice area, but a very fulfilling one to be in. I think my final question I want to ask is, can you paint a picture for us of where you hope we go as a profession? Like, do we need pediatric pelvic health OT in every town? Like, where do we need to go with this? It feels like the need is massive. Where do you hope we go?
Oh, my goodness. Yes, Sarah. Pediatric pelvic health OT in every single town in the United States would be my, like, dream utopia. Oh, my goodness. It is a massive undertaking, but I feel like we really need to move into the direction of integrating pelvic health curriculum into our OT programs. I mean, that's where it all starts. And if we have OT practitioners that are coming into the field and innovating practice, they are going to be able to move this movement forward because they'll be well equipped to start programs in organizations such as hospitals. They are going to be equipped to be opening up their own private practice in their rural town, maybe, you know, somewhere where there are no practitioners right now, but they see the need. And I think when we can provide that education to OT students in their programs, that's where the biggest change is going to happen. And then us practitioners who are already in this space and doing the work, that we continue to do the work to drive the research forward, because like your summary of the article stated, it's still limited research out there specifically done by occupational therapists in this space. And so if we can get the OT programs to have the curriculum, and then we start integrating doctoral capstone projects, continued research with our academic institutions, that's how we're going to get a better drive moving forward to kind of build the momentum for other practitioners to be able to have pediatric pelvic health OT in every single town and city in the United States.
Yeah, it feels like if we're going to claim toileting as one of our core ADLs, that we help address that. There's a lot of room for growth to up our game collectively in this area. I'm so thankful for what I learned from you on this podcast today, but I'm also like, oh, I can't believe I'm learning this for the first time right now. Like, so yeah, I'm excited for the future, and thank you for being such a pioneer in this area and actually doing the work, having the practice and teaching on it and sharing with us today. This has been an awesome conversation.
Thank you so much for having me, Sarah. It has been a dream to be on your podcast and also just to share all this amazing, you know, content about pediatric pelvic health OT and the need.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Wow, I just love when we get to hear from frontline clinicians, especially private practice owners. Balancing great care with running a successful business is some of the most challenging work in the OT world. So again, I am just so thankful to Quiara for letting us peek inside her OT brain. I especially loved hearing her process for goal setting. That felt so universally helpful. And again, I just loved all the specialty information also that she shared. This is obviously a really deep and emotional and complex practice area. And I appreciate her sharing all the learning and work that has gone into having this successful clinic. I'll be sharing the resources that we mentioned in this podcast in our show notes, so I definitely encourage you to check those out. And as always, I want to hear what your thoughts are on this episode. If you are a casual listener, we'd love a review from you. You can now review us on Google from our homepage, or we always appreciate your comments on our YouTube video. But the best place to really discuss the implications of this research is in the OT Potential Club. For our members in there, I'll be watching for your comments in our forum. And for our members, if you are interested in earning a CEU certificate for your time today, what you are going to do next is head to otpotential.com and sign in to the OT Potential Club. Once you are in there, you can take a 5-question test, and when you pass, we will generate a certificate for your time today. Okay, I want to thank you so much for joining us today. I hope this podcast helps keep you informed and inspired as an OT professional. Take care, and we'll talk next time.